there, get the heavy disc out. And that spot we got stuck this spring, you guys all remember that bottom that we couldn't plant. It was just too wet. It was just constantly getting stuck. Well, it overgrew with kochia and other weeds. We got some Russian thistle, some foxtail, all kinds of stuff growing in here. So I went ahead and got the 5 1/4. Well, I guess it's the 525/50, but we call it the 600 bud. And I hooked it up to our cross heavy disc. And I am working the snot out of this. So it's doing a pretty good job. It's about all I can do to cut these weeds up. I'll show you guys here. Take a look. There's about, I don't know, 15 acres here. We want to seed this to winter wheat. This bottom here is just, it's got a lot of water in it. It needs to be planted every year. So our goal, hopefully, is to rip this up and then come back here in a week or two and plant it to winter wheat. If we keep doing that, keep seeding this ground, we'll keep it from turning into an alkali flat, because it very well will go that way if we don't do this. Looking forward to getting this tractor fixed up. Every time I get in this thing, it just kind of makes me uneasy looking at the cracked window and the steering wheel that's all loose, and this cab needs a makeover bad. The tractor runs great, but the cab is a mess. The paint on this thing's rough. I want this tractor to look nice and get a new seat. This seat's terrible. So, yeah, that's the plan. We're hopefully going to do that this winter. No chemical involved here. These guys are at the mercy of brute force. Ruts where we got stuck with that Series 1 bud. I'm going to drive along the edge of it, let my disc fall in it. We'll see if I can just pull some of the sides in enough where if I keep doing that, then eventually we'll be able to farm across it. Take a look. It's a Kraus. Oh, there we are. Here's the tag. Let's see what this is. It's a model 2158 serial 1548. So 2158 Kraus. It's a 38 foot, I believe. I think it's a 38 foot. It might be a little narrower than that. It might be a 36. So this is it right here. I'm walking on it. Those tracks. You guys remember my video from the spring where I walked up to it? The tracks are right here. That bud was stuck right there. I've gone over this about 4 or 5 times. Just carefully pulled the sides in. Eventually I could drive over the top. Look at this. That's mud still. This bottom here, it's just there must be a formation underneath here that holds the water. And that's why we're going to get this to winter wheat. We're just going to rip all this up. I'm going to keep plowing on it. Get this whole bottom seeded to winter wheat. Probably the whole field, but we'll at least seed this bottom. And we're just going to crop this spot every year. And that should take care of our water problem here. And I more than likely will grow some pretty nice crops on it. How tall as kochia gets? It's not uncommon for kochia to get 5, even 6 feet tall in some areas. Majority of it's about that 3 to 4 feet, but kochia is a terrible plant. Someone out there needs to design a use for this stuff, and then we'd be filthy rich. Filthy rich. Maybe. No. Okay, all right, let's get back to work. Enough playing around. The sound of a 19 liter engine. It's KTA 19 roaring in there. It's a solid engine. Take it out of neutral. Just throttle it up. Howdy again. Let's try it again. Hello. No. How about yo? So we're in the process of getting fertilizer set up on the farm. Basically, we're gonna be seeding some winter wheat. We got the air drill at the shop. The bud's getting some tires changed on at the minute. I called around and found some fertilizer that could be delivered today, actually. It was kind of a short notice, so we went ahead and got our other 13-inch auger set up on the 7140 Magnum. I'm going to back it over these bins here, these Meridian bins we have put up, and then we will get them loaded with fertilizer. At least one of them we're going to have filled all the way up, so that way we'll be able to make it through winter wheat planting. Okay, looks like we're doing the north bin. Got to move the vac. I parked the 4520 there the other day. You guys saw it in the other video, so my dad just jumped in it, and he's going to move that out of the way for me. So I'm keep backing this up. There we go. Okay, let's put her back in reverse. We might have it right there. Set it down a little bit. We don't use this auger very much. We bought it 8-9 years ago. It's a little off center. As someone, whoever the previous owner had, backed it into something at one point in time and bent the flighting inside a little bit. We straightened the tube out, but the flighting's still off a little bit, so it rattles a bunch. But we went in one year this came apart in the center. There's a flighting joint in it. When that happened, we were in the middle of harvest, and rather than trying to fix this thing, we decided we better get another auger as a backup. So we bought that International Harvester auger, which is an 82 foot. I think this is a 70 foot, 13 inch. So now this one gets used for fertilizer, and occasionally it's our backup. Here's what's going on over here. Got Mark's tire out. And they are doing a bunch of tire swapping here. So we're putting new tires on the insides. So that way we don't have to deal with them again, because it's a pain getting the change of tires on the inside dual. You have to take off the outside dual. So we want new tires on the inside. These are old tires. We're just figuring out which ones are the best to go on the outsides, like this one right here. They're looking at it. Those guys are over there looking at that tire. Everybody's looking at tires. But yeah, he'll get this thing put together. I'm waiting for the truck of fertilizer. It's gonna come around the corner any minute over here, and I'll show him where to go. Okay, the fertilizer truck's following me in. Right back there. And he's got 34 ton of just urea on him. So we'll get that offloaded under the bin. And then I believe two more trucks are coming our way. So that should get us enough to hopefully get a couple thousand acres of winter wheat in. Okay. Going in. Truck number two. Going in the hopper. We can take one more after this. All right. Want to go up? Okay. Let's do it. It's a little sketchy being up here. We don't have a cage on these things. Take a look at this. Tall this is, but it's tall enough. So it's getting later. It's 8 p.m. We basically have tomorrow to try to seed some winter wheat, and then there's rain coming Wednesday, Thursday. We're talking up to a half inch of rain between both days, which would shut us down for probably the whole week. And then Monday, Tuesday next week, they're talking another half inch rain, which is awesome. We need the rain. It's great. It's just, we don't have a lot of time to seed. So we're going to try to push through tonight, get this bud ready, and maybe hammer out a couple acres tomorrow, get 100, 200 if everything runs okay. We've got fertilizer on the farm right now. The truck just took off down the road right there. Leg Arms is getting some shanks for the air drill. I'm going to install the GPS system. I'm going to show you guys how we put these Trimble systems in this tractor. No, I did not get paid by Trimble to do this, but everybody always asks about our GPS and our big buds, so I'll show you how we do it. So let's install this real quick. I got my antifreeze box here with a good $8,000 worth of GPS stuff here. First thing I'm gonna do, this is the antenna. This is what talks to the satellites, at least receives data from the satellites. And we put a bolt, we drilled a hole in the front of this hood here and put a bolt through for this screw on there. There is, as you can see, magnet. There is magnets on this, but it scratches the paint, which I just put that on there. So you take the antenna, you hold the phone up so you guys can actually see what I'm doing here, and just thread it on. There we go. We like to put the antennas on the very front of the machine. because that is the as soon as the tractor starts turning or anything happens, the front of the tractor is what's going to get the most sensitivity first rather than the top of the cab. So we just always have put them up here. The cable from the antenna into the cab. So let's go ahead and feed that through. Okay, so here's the 750 monitor. And we have a bracket right here for it attached to. I believe it's the RAM mounts. Works pretty good. So the Easy Steer motor will go right here, and that'll ride the steering wheel. And then the monitor is going to go right here. So I'm going to quickly put those on. I just went ahead and got the main monitor display attached. I'll line that up where I want to name ready here in a second. There's three bolts here that we have on this bracket to attach the Easy Steer motor on. Just tighten the nuts up underneath like that. So I basically just determine the tilt of the steering wheel so it lines up pretty evenly on the foam wheel here. So let's go ahead and put the gyro box on. Okay, I think I got it all set up. Pile of cords right here, as you can see. Basically, there's two cables that plug into the back of your display monitor here. And those run to your controller, which I call the gyro box, but your controller, Easy Steer controller. It's got two bolts, right? One right here, one over here. That mounts that down to the same bracket that holds your Easy Steer motor. When you're ready to go to auto steer, you just pull this down, clicks on your steering wheel. I might have to align that a little better. I see it's kind of crooked, but it'll be okay for now. And then I got to go through the monitor here. And the power is supplied by this cable right here. So that plugs into the 12-volt system. Got the monitor on, Easy Steer's on. All this is attached, this cable right here. That goes to the antenna, runs under there. I've got it zip tied along some hydraulic lines. Comes up over the hood right here, goes to the antenna. That's basically the whole GPS system right here. So now I've got to go to settings in this thing. Vehicle setup. And we got to change everything to articulated four-wheel drive tractor. And wheelbase. So I got to go through and figure out the numbers and everything we haven't written down. Put everything in for this application, this tractor. The width of the app, the implement being pulled, everything like that. And then the GPS will be ready to go. So I'll go ahead and get that done. So leg arms is cleaning off the rollers. Those meter the product coming out of the cart. We didn't do that this spring. Usually we do, we just didn't get to it. So they sat in some seed fertilizer, but we'll get those cleaned up, make sure the bearings and those are all good. The other day I was climbing on the implement here. This is the 5000 series, 57 foot flex coil. And these are the manifolds. The product comes up the big tube, shoots up this way with a velocity of air and hits this little point right here. And then that distributes the product evenly through all these hoses, which then take it down to the shanks. So I went through and inspected every one of these. There were some straw, some feathers. Sometimes I'll find a dead mouse in here or a rock even. I found rocks up here. So. And this is the Intelligent Solutions blockage system that's on as well. So I'm basically just walking across here without falling down, because it's going to happen one of these days. You can get hurt pretty bad stepping across this. We used to play on these as kids and run up and down them. Well, I guess not these, more of a Freakstad plow. A little less hoses on there. So, but yeah, it's just a matter of time for one of us to eat it. It's just going to happen. So yeah, I just got to go through. There's eight of these. Go through and put all the caps back in, so I'm working my way across this. You see we have a couple red shanks here. That's from an older drill that we had. It's still got some good shanks on it, so we've been replacing the ones on these that are bent or broke along, so got that done. We capped all these press wheels a couple years ago, so they should run a while. We're getting as much life out of this drill as we can. This one's definitely the older one. I wanted to say this is a 2001 drill, so our other one's a 2006. But if you keep fixing these things, you can get a lot of acres out of them. So we're just gonna keep running it till eventually we decide to upgrade the whole drill. Okay, let's see. I don't see a pin on the back of that. I don't see one here either. Maybe it's got it in the cab. Oh, actually it's behind it. Okay, it's right there. It is gonna be a little low. So I'm gonna crank this a few times. Yeah, see if that's enough. There we go. Okay, now I gotta raise this back up. got her hooked up. Now we can clean up some of this kosher around here too. It's been sitting under these drills. This drill is in a little better shape than the other one. It's a 2006, a lot less acres on it. Still has its share of problems, but it's a good drill. See, it's been there a while. So leg arms is hooking the hydraulics up for me. You have two more of these. Yeah, I do. Or I thought I did. This is a John Deere. That has Pioneer ends on it, so he has to have an adapter to hook into the hydraulics on this. So we're going to fire this up again. Try to raise the... Finished chopping off 2 feet off the back of this bed. It was a little long the way this thing was designed. It hinged pretty far up front. I mean, the bed stuck out about 4 feet from the hinge point, so when you lifted it up all the way down here, it would crush the pan right there to the auger, to the grain cart. So we decided to chop off some of the bed. Easiest way to fix that problem. So just finished that. Little leftovers from that bed. All right, rolling up to the bin here. We just had about, what was that, 68 ton of urea put inside the north hopper here. I see I have an auger I gotta move out of the way, so we'll start the tractor up, get that out of there. Okay, that's good. I think it's just a 40 foot. Yeah, I think it's, yeah, it's about 40 feet. It's brand auger. It's not too bad to move this thing around, but it takes a, little bit of strength. Take the hitch off. Put a battery in it. Ugh. There we go. Nice about this engine is it doesn't take a lot of amps to crank over. So I don't have to tighten these up. I can just do it by hand. Tension. There's our gas tank. Put the tube in here. Suck up some. See if she runs. Perfect. I need this tractor to run the grain vac. You can see I have the rock picker on it from just the other day. I was picking all that rock. So let's take this over and drop the rock picker, and then we'll hook it up to the vac. Dad's taking the green Ford over. He's gonna get seed wheat with that. We just got the vac hooked up with the 4520. And then I'm gonna take this guy. Got the first drill in the ground. We just shut the tractor down. Basically, we filled her up with seeds, all filled her up with fertilizer, calibrated it, checked things look good. Took it out to the CRP land that we've been ripping up. It's pretty soft. And well, not a lot of moisture. We had some rain the other day. It just didn't accumulate to much. Being turned over, the soil doesn't have a lot of moisture in it. There's just not much there to sprout the winter wheat. And there's not much in the forecast for like a week at least. So we got time to plant, but what we're thinking, we drove over to another field, and I think what we're going to do is we're going to go ahead and move this unit to some stubble or some kemp fallow, some fallow land. It seemed to have a little more moisture in it, a little more mellow, even though this has been turned over a bunch. I think it's got a better chance of getting a good sprout going, so we're going to seed all that first. There's 1,000 acres over there, and then we'll come back over here, and hopefully by the time we come back over here, either we'll have a rain on this, or we'll just go ahead and seed it and hope it rains then too. So, but let's take a look at the ground real quick. Nothing like fresh white paint. When I say fresh, at least a year old, but it sure looks good in the sun when the sun's like this. The sod that was there before, all the alfalfa, the grass, all that, well, it doesn't break down when your first couple times plowing it. And so what ends up happening is you get kind of uneven, chunky ground. We did a test seed here, and you can see how it's just all this grass material, and it's just cloddy like that. You know, that's just not a great seed bed. You really want softer soil. That's just hard. And when we dug down, the seed placement was just kind of sporadic. Some areas it would be down 2 inches, other areas down about an inch. Let's see if I can find, oh, there's one right there. You can see the kernel grain right there. You know, that's probably, judging from the distance here, that's a good two and a half inches deep right there. But then when you go out to the wings, you know, it's shallower. And it's not that the drill is necessarily that out of level. We do need to level it, but it's just the type of soil this is. So we're gonna move on to the other area, but that's just what you do. Well, that concludes this video. It's probably gonna be a long video for all the amount of film that I've had so far. I don't know if I'm split in two or not. You guys will obviously find out by watching it. But thanks for watching. I'm gonna go home and I'm gonna go edit all this up and get it up on YouTube. So while I have time, because tonight I think we're gonna take the rest of the evening off and then start seeding tomorrow. So I'll have time to sit on the computer for a couple hours and hammer this video out. But yeah, if you guys like what you see, subscribe to the channel. There'll be a little button pop up on the top left corner of your screen. And it might be that side. I'm not sure which side this is. And yeah, subscribe to us. Like us on Facebook, Instagram, or even on Twitter. Check out our website if you want merchandise. We got hats, shirts, all kinds of good stuff. Bumper stickers. And you can go from there. So, and there's some cool things happening in the future here. We got some cool events happening. And so I have some hardware that'll hopefully let us live stream better. So yeah, stay tuned, guys. Thanks for being a part of the channel. You're awesome. We're getting close to 100,000 subscribers, so let's get there. Later.